Just give me 2 minutes, I'll put up the slide. Okay, can you see my slide, everyone?
Yes.
Okay, so we did this example last class. And did we do this example? I kind of forgot. We did this example, right? So I showed you like how aliasing happens with a cosine signal. Did we do this? Where were we actually? Just give me any recall? I think we covered all this. These equations I remember. And we came up to this, is it not?
Yes, sir.
I think we were here. Did we do this example? Anyway, it doesn't matter. I can cover it again. Okay, so just let me go back a little bit here. And let me just slowly recapitulate. So we were talking about the sampling from OpenM and Schaefer. So I had discussed how the DFT, continuous time Fourier transform of this particular signal XST is related with XCT. That is what we had discussed, and we had seen that this was the equation. This is the continuous time Fourier transform. So this gives us infinite repetitions of the original spectrum. So this was your band limited signal, the continuous time signal, that is XCT. It has the Fourier transform, continuous time Fourier transform, XC j omega, omega capital. And it has band limited from omega n to minus omega n. This is S j omega, that is the impulse train in the frequency domain. So that is given like this. And time domain multiplication is equivalent to frequency domain convolution. So we are convolving these two signals. When we convolve these two signals, we get infinite spectra or infinite repetitions of the original spectrum. And if we want to avoid aliasing, then we have to respect the fact that omega s minus omega n should be greater than omega n. So that is the condition that will lead to the sampling theorem, that is omega should be greater than 2 omega n. And for the case of undersampling, we'll have the distortion, which is aliasing distortion. And I think last class we had stopped here. And we had seen later that there is a reconstruction filter that we have to apply after this signal is sampled and you have got infinite spectrum. You take out the baseband version. That means you want to take out the spectrum at the origin, this guy. And to do that, this is a scaled version, 1D scaling. So you want to have a pass filter which will make this back to one. So the low pass filter will have an amplitude of T, and we had seen that this was the condition from the sampling theorem. And the filter, low pass filter, is this. It is extending from omega C to minus omega C, where omega C is the cutoff frequency of the low pass filter. So if you check here, this cutoff frequency is generally equal to omega S by 2. That is for the book of Fatih. So there he had taken omega C as omega S by 2. Although in general, it can be greater than omega N plus than omega S minus N, omega. So this has a scale in T so that it cancels 1 by T in the repeated spectrum. And you are going to get back the original baseband spectrum. This is the reconstructed signal XR j omega in the frequency domain. So the reconstructed signal is XRT. Now XRT should be equal to XCT at least at the places where XCT is sampled. So please pay attention to what I am saying. Okay, all of you are able to hear me? All of you are able to hear me? Yeah, so this is the statement that I'm making, that XRT should be equal to XCT at least at the discrete instance where XCT is sampled. Okay, there. So there is a qualification that I'm making, that XRT may not be equal to all of XCT. Okay, so please pay attention to what I'm saying. So that is why, like, we always think of the reconstruction happening. The original continuous time signal is very dense. It is infinite. It is having infinite number of points. So at least XRT should be equal to XST at the place where XCT is sampled. So this is the situation. Just take a look here. XRT should be equal to XST at the place where XCT is sampled. Now, I'll come to this point a little later. Now, XRT is the output of this reconstruction filter HRJ omega. And I had discussed that if you want to avoid aliasing, you should have one more filter before this guy. Okay, before you do sampling, you should have one more filter. So that filter is called the anti-aliasing filter. That will remove all components beyond a certain frequency, that is omega S by 2, which is the cutoff frequency of the low-pass filter, HRJ omega, so that you don't get aliasing. And that you should do before sampling. Please make note of whatever I'm saying, because these are important points which you should understand. Okay. Fine. So this is the slide where you see there is aliasing. So I had said that there is a low pass filter which is having a cutoff omega C equal to omega S by 2 here. Now let us do this example. I don't remember whether I did this example or not, so let me just tell you this example again. So XCT is equal to cos omega naught T, where like omega naught is some frequency. And we will analyze two cases where omega naught is less than omega S by 2 and where it is violated, that condition is violated. So when there is no aliasing, omega naught is or rather omega S is greater than 2 omega naught. So the sampling frequency is greater than the maximum frequency that is there in the signal. And here there is only one frequency, that is omega naught. So the Fourier domain representation of XCT is XCJ omega, where you have got two impulses at omega naught and minus omega naught. And you are applying a low pass filter. So the low pass filter is going from here to here. Okay, so it is including omega naught, and therefore you get proper reconstruction. If omega naught is less than omega s by 2, that means omega s by 2 is here. Okay, so there is a division sign here. Maybe it is not clearly visible in the slide, but omega s by 2 is here, right? All of you can see my cursor? There is a division sign here.
Yes, sir.
So omega naught is less than pi by t, omega s equal to t, and omega s by 2 is equal to pi by t. Not less than pi by t, so the correct signal. So this will give you omega naught less than pi by t, no aliasing. Now here omega naught is greater than pi by t, so that is omega s is less than 2 omega naught. So here you get aliasing. So the filter is extending from omega s by 2 to minus omega s by 2, and your omega naught is actually outside omega s by 2. So here you don't get the proper signal. Rather, what you're getting is the signal which is centered here and whose minus omega naught is here. This dotted line you see? Okay? So this is the, so let us go through the text. So here's 4.5 D and E correspond to the Fourier transform of the low filter for omega naught less than omega s by 2, that is pi by t, and omega naught greater than pi by t respectively, with omega c equal to omega s by 2. So figures 4.5 C and E, they correspond C. C is this term. C and E correspond to the case of aliasing. But with no aliasing, figures 4.5 B and D, the reconstructed output is XRT equal to cos omega naught T. With aliasing, you get these two impulses, which are located at omega S minus omega naught and minus omega S minus omega naught. So this dot is coming from the other side. So with aliasing, the reconstructed output is this, cos of omega S minus omega naught T. That is, the higher frequency omega naught has taken on the identity or alias of the lower frequency cos of omega s minus omega naught. So this aliasing means that the higher frequency is alias as lower frequency. So that is the problem. So we'll see with numbers how this actually happens. We'll do one more example. So here the important thing to see is that inside the spectrum, inside the band or bandwidth spanned by the filter, this is for the aliasing case. So you see that you have this dotted impulse. So that is happening because you have the spectrum centered here, which is entering into this. And the original spectrum, which is centered at origin, has the impulse which is solid shown here. That is omega naught. So omega s minus omega is this guy. Okay, that is getting recovered in the positive side. Similarly, minus of omega s minus omega naught is getting recovered here. The spectrum which is sitting here, it has these two impulses. Okay. So this impulse is sitting at minus omega s minus omega naught. Okay, so that way you get this guy and you get this guy. So this dotted impulse is coming from contribution of the sitting at omega s, and this solid impulse is coming from the contribution sitting at minus omega s. Whereas here, if you for the no aliasing case, you have the dotted impulse here outside omega s by 2. It doesn't enter inside. The contribution of the spectrum sitting at omega s is this dotted impulse, which doesn't enter the region which is the bandwidth of the low pass filter. So it is outside the bandwidth of the low pass filter. It is greater than omega s by 2. Therefore, it doesn't get captured by the low pass filter. The low pass filter rejects it. So this guy is not reconstructed. Similarly, if you see the solid line, this solid line corresponds to the contribution from this fellow. So at the spectrum at minus omega s has this impulse as the contribution. It is not entering the original spectrum. It is not entering the bandwidth of the low pass filter. So the low pass filter is only reconstructing these two impulses. It is not reconstructing this fellow. Whereas for the aliasing case, the solid line is entering inside the low pass filter bandwidth. All of you understood? Whatever I'm explaining? Is it okay? You can compare this diagram with this diagram, and then you will understand. This is for no aliasing case, this is for aliasing case. Is it okay, everyone? Why nobody is responding? I don't know why.
Yes, sir.
And day by day, I find that less and less people are coming. I don't know why. It's very strange. I'm trying to explain and I'm trying to go slow and all that, but I don't see people coming to class. Anyway, so maybe it is placement time for you, so classes are not a primary thing. Okay. So we have now seen that how aliasing causes the appearance of low frequency components inside the original spectrum. So that is what we just saw. The original spectrum was having frequency omega naught, but now the reconstruction filter is reconstructing omega s minus omega naught. So this is the low pass version of omega, or low frequency version of omega naught, which is low frequency aliased version of omega naught. So that is the reason why it is called aliasing. So we have now looked at an example from aliasing, and we have, in a previous case, we have learned how to relate the continuous time Fourier transform of the sampled signal XST with the continuous time Fourier transform of the original continuous time signal XC j omega. That is what we had learned. So this was the expression. XS j omega is equal to 1 by T times XC j omega minus K omega S. So that was what we had derived earlier. Now we want to derive the relation between the DTFT of XN. So where is XN? XN is the output of, let's see. Here is XST, and I had one more diagram. Yeah, here we had XN. So we had XCT, which was in continuous time domain. Then you had the impulse train, whose axis was also continuous time domain. Then you sampled. That means you multiplied these two guys. That means you performed a modulation operation of XCT with ST. Multiplication is modulation. So you got XST, which was again having discrete samples, and now you are going to convert this discrete sequence into a digital sequence, that is X of N. So that is XC of NT. So now you are going to take a DTFT here, because this is a digital signal, and you are going to relate it with the continuous time Fourier transform of XCT. That is what we want to do now. So if I see this equation, we are going to use the formula that small omega is equal to capital omega into T. Okay, so this is the relation we are going to use. The XC j omega is the DTFT formula, or the DTFT of X of N is given like this. So here you replace omega, small omega is equal to capital omega into T. So XS j omega is equal to X e to the power j omega T, or omega at equal to capital omega into T. So you get here X S j omega equal to, here XN is equal to XC and T, e power minus j omega, small omega is equal to e power minus j capital omega T into N. Okay. So this gives you the relationship of XSG omega. Now, in the original formula of XSG omega, it was equal to 1 by T XCG omega minus K omega S. So this is XSG omega. XSG omega is equal to X e to the power j omega t. And you can now write this expression where you have converted this whole expression with small omega. So X e to the power j small omega equal to 1 by t XC j omega divided by t minus 2 pi k by t. Omega s is equal to 2 pi by t. That's why it is 2 pi divided by t. So this is the relation between the continuous time Fourier transform of XCT and the discrete time Fourier transform of X of n. Okay, I think I had covered up to this last class. So this was the idea. Who's coming now, Baba? Okay, this is fine.
Yes.
Okay, let us see another example. This example is going to be a little interesting, and this will explain aliasing more. So suppose here you have numbers, so here you can understand better. So if we sample a continuous time signal, XCT is equal to cos of 4000 pi into T. With sampling period T equal to 1 by 6000. Okay. Then what happens? So capital T is equal to 1 by 6,000 seconds. And this is your frequency, capital omega, cos of omega T, where capital omega is equal to 4,000 pi. Now here, because when you in Oppenheim and Schaeffer, whenever you have continuous time signal, you have capital omega. And when you have a discrete signal, you have small omega. So when you sample this guy, you obtain x of n, which is equal to xc of nt, that is obtained as cos of 4000 pi into capital Tn. So that is equal to cos of small omega naught into n, where omega naught is equal to 4000 pi t. So if you multiply t with 4000 pi, you are getting 4000 pi divided by 6000, that is equal to 2 pi by 3. So small omega naught is equal to 2 pi by 3. This is what you have to now understand. So we will initially have XS G omega, which is the continuous time Fourier transform of XST. And that will have everything in capital omega. So you see here, this impulse is at 4000 pi. Okay, this is cos capital omega T. So capital omega is equal to 4000 pi. You will have another graph showing you everything in small omega. Okay, so just be careful about this conversions. So small omega naught is equal to 2 pi by 3. So this guy, this impulse, which is sitting at 4000 pi, if you change the axis to small omega, it will be 2 pi by 3. So the sampling period, sampling frequency is equal to 2 pi divided by t, where t is equal to 1 by 6000, that is equal to 12,000 pi. Okay. And the highest frequency of the signal, omega, capital omega naught, is equal to 4000 pi. So if you see here, omega s is much greater than 2 omega naught. It is 12,000 pi, which is greater than 2 omega naught, which is 8,000 pi. Is it not? So the conditions of Nyquist sampling theorem or the Shannon sampling theorem are satisfied, and there is no aliasing. So the Fourier transform of XCT will be given this. So the low-pass filter will extend from minus omega s by 2 to capital omega s by 2, and it will have a scaling capital T. So you are going to get back pi delta omega minus 4000 pi plus pi delta omega. Here you have a scaling here, pi by T. Then sign here, pi by T everywhere. Okay. Because xg omega is equal to 1 by T, summation k equal to minus infinity plus infinity, xcg omega minus k omega s. Okay. That's the formula. So this k factor of capital T looks cancel this, and you're going to get back the original signal. So is this clear, everyone? So our low pass filter is actually 6,000 minus 1 by, that is omega by 2 to minus s by 2. So just in version of the previous diagram. So once you're okay, just let me know.
Yes, sir.
Fine. So now you see this axis is smaller. So small omega is related to capital omega by this equation. X e to the omega is equal to x s g omega, that is equal to small omega b. And you see the same is centered at is on 2 pi by 3. So using the relation between small omega and capital omega, you can get the two impulses at 2 pi by 3 and minus 2 pi by 3. One more thing has happened, which is although the frequency is now shown at 2 pi by 3 and minus 2 pi by 3, the two impulses are now shown like this. There is one more thing that happened. When you scale the axis, you have scaled the impulses also, the strength of the impulses. So earlier you had delta of capital omega. Capital omega is equal to small omega by T. So by the scaling property of the Dirac delta, you have this particular output T into delta omega. So delta omega is this impulse, and T is getting multiplied with it. So the original impulse here was delta of capital omega. That was pi by T. Now you have delta of small omega. So delta of small capital omega is related to delta of small omega by this relation. So this relation is the scaling property of Dirac delta function. So you have function, or rather this property delta of A into S is 1 by mod A into delta of X, which is the property of the scaling property of the continuous time Dirac delta function, which has been used to show that the amplitude of the delta small omega is pi by t into t, that is equal to pi. So when you converted the impulses from capital omega to small omega, this thing also has happened. Okay. 4000 pi now corresponds to the normalized frequency small omega naught equal to 2 pi by 3. And small omega naught is less than pi. So 2 pi by 3 is less than pi here. So when there is no aliasing, when omega s is greater than 2 omega naught, you will get proper reconstruction. So this will lead to the proper signal. 4000 pi will come out, or 2 pi by 3 will come out. Now let us see what happens when there is undersampling. Okay. So we have another signal. Earlier we had 4000 pi t. Now we have another signal in the time domain, which is in the continuous time domain, which is xct equal to cos 16,000 pi t. And the sampling period is retained as 1 by 6,000 seconds. Okay. So now, if you look at this particular frequency, this is capital omega naught, and omega s is 12,000 pi. So 16,000 pi is greater than 12,000 pi. So omega s, which is equal to 2 pi by t equal to 12,000 pi, is less than 2 omega naught, that is equal to 32,000 pi. So we have a situation where the Nyquist or the sampling theorem is not obeyed, and we will see aliasing. We will see aliasing, but there will be an interesting thing that will happen. That let us see what happens. So because of this particular frequency, 16,000 pi, yeah, that is capital omega is equal to 16,000 pi, xs g omega will be identical to that of the previous case. This here omega s is 12,000 pi, so omega s minus 12,000 at one pulse is sitting here at 4 pi. Okay. That is very interesting. So the same xs g omega will come for this particular signal cos 16,000 pi t, and sampling period is 1/6,000 seconds. And now the impulse related equal to minus 1 pi is omega minus omega s. That is 4 pi here. Take omega minus omega s. Omega s is pi. And omega s is 12,000 pi. So omega s omega s omega s. So 12, so rather it is small omega is 16,000. Omega s is 12,000. So that is 4,000. The located at omega equal to pi. Pi is from xc j omega minus omega s, and this is the aliasing part. And the impulse at omega equal to 4000 pi is from xc j omega plus omega s. So your omega was 16,000 pi plus omega s is 18,000. This is plus 12,000 pi. So 16,000 pi plus 12,000, that is 28,000, and that is coming from this guy sitting here. wrong here. If you move from here, you will reach here. Okay. You can just calculate that why this impulse at omega equal to 4000 pi is sitting. So this is coming from the impulse centered at minus omega s, and this minus 4000 pi is sitting is coming from the spectrum located at plus omega s. Okay. So if you plot xc j omega, that is equal to xs j omega by capital T as a function of omega, yields the same graph as shown in 4.6b. So now what has happened is that the two pulses are coming at the same, or the two impulses are coming at the same place. Okay. Now the sequence of samples is the same in both the cases, because if you add 2 pi n to 4000 pi, you are going to get back the same signal cos of small omega naught into t, that is equal to, or small omega naught into n. So cos omega naught n is the discrete time sequence, that is equal to cos 2 pi n by 3. So cos 16,000 pi n divided by 6,000. So that is, if you convert this guy to discrete time, that is, if you convert this analog or this continuous time signal to discrete time, then you are going to do this cos of omega naught into n capital T. So when you do that, you get, and if you add 2 pi to that, you are going to get back the original signal cos 2 pi n by 3. That is why same signal, which is cos 2 pi n by 3. So this particular signal is going to produce the same discrete version. So that means this is a many-to-one mapping. There are many continuous time signals which will produce the same discrete sequence. So if you go reverse, that is, if you have cos 2 pi n by 3, then you may land up with cos 16,000 pi t instead of cos 4,000 pi t because of aliasing. Okay? Did you understand this point, everyone? So you have cos 2 pi n by 3 after sampling. You have recovered cos 2 pi n by 3 after sampling, but it has come from cos 16,000 pi t. Earlier, because of aliasing, it is coming from some other continuous time signal. It is not coming from cos 4000 pi t. So aliasing causes the inverse mapping becomes disturbed. Okay. So it is not unique. So aliasing causes the inversion of, or the continuous time signal that you recover from the aliased discrete signal is a different signal. So that is why aliasing distortion causes non-faithful or a distorted version of the continuous time signal that will get reconstructed if you use aliased signal. So if there is undersampling, it can lead to some other continuous time signal. It will not go back to the original continuous time signal from where you got the samples. So this part shows that aliasing is a problematic distortion. And what we have seen is till now is that if you see, aliasing will cause high frequency signals to masquerade as low frequency signals. So what is happening is that this cos 16,000 pi t is now behaving as a cos 4,000 pi t signal, because the discrete sequence is the same for both cases. So whatever you are recovering is a different signal as compared to the original signal 16,000 pi t. This is also an important point to understand from this example. So the original frequency was 16,000 pi t, but you are now getting a signal which is 4,000 pi t if you do the reconstruction. Because the discrete version is cos 2 pi n by 3, which is the same for both 4,000 pi t and for 16,000 pi t. Okay, is this clear?
Yes, sir.
So this example is something that is eye-opening, and it shows that how sampling can, or how like undersampling can distort the reconstruction of the original continuous time signal. Okay. So now let us come to like whatever we learned from VP-Lattie, that the Whittaker-Shannon formula for ideal deconstruction of the or the ideal interpolation formula. Let us look at how Oppenheim, Schaeffer, he has described it. So some notations are different, so that's why I'm including it. And there are some new things also, so let us look at it. So given a sequence of samples x of n, we can form an impulse train xs of t. That means given this guy, so one more, right here. So given xn of t, we want to get xs of t. So that you can get by writing xs t as equal to summation n equal to minus infinity plus infinity x of n into delta of t minus nt. So this is the impulse train, and x of n is xc of nt. Okay, these are just weights of the Dirac delta impulses. So if this impulse train is the input to an ideal low pass continuous time filter with the frequency response hr of j omega and impulse response hr of t, then the output of the filter will be just x of n into hr t minus nt. Okay. So this is the property of the Dirac delta impulse. So you are feeding multiple Dirac delta impulses into the system, so it is going to produce hr of t minus nt. That is the definition of impulse response. So your signal can be now written as scaled and shifted, or a weighted summation of scaled and shifted impulse responses of the low pass filter. So hr of t minus nt, where hr of t is the impulse response of the low pass filter, hr, capital hr j omega, then this guy will be actually the shifted impulse response, and x of n is weighting those impulse responses. And we had earlier discussed that this impulse response for a ideal low pass filter is a sinc function, so we will have weighted sinks which are shifted in time. So we are going to add infinite number of weighted sinks to recover back our continuous time signal. So this, like we'll see, like finally we'll derive that Whittaker-Shannon formula for ideal interpolation. So this is your block diagram. You have x of n. You are converting x of n to an impulse train. Convert from sequence to impulse train. So at sampling period t, you will get back xst. Xst is the impulse train, and this x of n is a discrete set of sequence, is a discrete sequence. So you are converting from a discrete sequence to an impulse train. Now this is in time, continuous time domain, xs of t, and ideal deconstruction filter you will place after that, and you will get back xc of t. So here the ideal deconstruction filter has a gain of capital T to compensate for the factor 1 by T in the relation xs j omega is equal to 1 by t summation k equal to minus infinity plus infinity xc j omega minus k omega s. So that relation, and a cutoff frequency omega c between omega n and omega s minus omega n, ideally it is taken as omega s by 2. So omega s by 2 is equal to pi by capital T. So as long as omega s is greater than 2 omega n, you don't have aliasing. So if the low pass filter looks like this, it is extending from omega s by 2 to minus omega s by 2. This is your ideal deconstruction filter, HR of J capital omega. Then also you note that there is a scale factor capital T. Then if you do this formula, x of n into small HR T minus NT, that is the impulse response of this guy. So the impulse response of this guy is this. So this is a sinc function. So the sinc function is given like this. So HR of T is equal to sine pi x by pi x, the sinc of x form. So then you can write out the full formula, xr of t is equal to x of n into hr t minus nt. We can write this formula. This is the ideal interpolation formula. This is your Shannon-Whittaker formula. Okay. Is this clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if you see what is happening, this is xc of t, which is the continuous time signal, and this is xs of t. So this is the discrete time version of this fellow, and this is again an impulse train. So xr of t that you construct is interpolating between these samples. And it is interpolating in such a way that the sinc function is decaying to zero at exactly the other sample. So here it is positive. It is actually equal to one. If you see here, the maximum value of the sinc function is one. And it decays to zero at exactly capital T. And at all plus minus NT, it is equal to zero. At 2t also it is 0, 3t it is 0, 4t it is 0. So you see here, the interpolation that is happening between two samples is happening in such a way that at the next time instant, the previous sinc's contribution disappears. Okay? And the sinc function is a basis function. So just like cos and sine, which are basis functions, or exponentials, which are basis functions, complex exponentials are basis functions for the Fourier series. Similarly, the sinc function is a basis function. And you use the sinc functions or sum of weighted sincs to reconstruct back the original continuous time signal. The interpolated continuous time signal. Okay. So this is the description. So the ideal low-pass filter will interpolate between the impulses of XS of t to reconstruct a continuous time signal XC of t. So the resulting signal is an exact reconstruction of XCT at the sampling times. So now we have a block diagram of an ideal band limited signal reconstruction, and that is called a discrete to continuous converter. So the left hand side you have the input as X of n, which is discrete signal, and on the right hand side you have XRT, which is a continuous time signal, and it is supposed to be identical to XCT at the sampling instance. Okay. Read this sentence carefully. The resulting signal is an exact reconstruction of XCT at the sampling times. Okay. So how do you achieve it? You achieve it using, first of all, you're converting X of n to an impulse term, that is XS of t, and then an ideal reconstruction filter is there, HR of j omega, which in combination, this in cascade, will lead to an ideal reconstruction system, which is called a discrete to continuous converter, or also called a discrete to analog converter, or DA converter, DAC. So you have ADC and DAC. So analog to digital and digital to analog. Full of the fact that we are talking about base band limited signals, all the while we are discussing the case of base and pass band also, for which you have the band pass sampling theorem. We are only discussing the base band, and there are not band limited. Or sorry, communications CMS code division multiplex. Thank you.